Now it's time for the tracks of my years. And guess what? All this week we are celebrating Radio 2's 50th birthday.
You're in tune with Radio 2 on 433-330 and Stereo VHF.
Well, we went back then, we certainly were. And all this week we are celebrating by hearing from some former Radio 2 presenters from their glory days. And today, well, let's hear one of the most iconic of all radio signature tunes. Well, that music will remind you hugely of two-way family favourites as it was, worldwide family favourites as it became, and on the very second day of Radio 2's existence, on the Sunday, the 1st of October, Michael Aspel introduced that very programme from the BBC in London, and he's on the line to us now. Hello, Mike.
Ken, hello. I didn't know that was me. Good Lord.
Yes.
Long time ago.
And various others around the world on that particular programme. But it was a lovely programme to do, I imagine.
Well, it was. Of course, it had only been two-way family favourites before, and now then it became worldwide, and it was my first experience of getting into the BBC studios and doing a major programme. It was thrilling.
What was Radio 2 like in those early days? Can you recall?
Well, I've been brought up on the home service and the light programme, and so it was all entirely new to me. And the only studios that I knew were the cosy little one in Cardiff, where I did children's hour serial plays, and the austere kind of hall at Alexandra Palace, where I'd done the news. So I came down to Broadcasting House for family favourites, and I was quite scared, because there was something very overwhelming about the foyer of Broadcasting House then. I've never been to the new one. And then I went down into the basement studio and got this tremendously warm welcome, which was from the team. There was a huge team involved. And my first instruction was to go up to the whatever floor to get the tea and the newspapers. That was my job as presenter. That was my, you know, so I knew I was in a kind of family atmosphere, which was marvellous.
It also beautifully demonstrated the pecking order on the BBC, didn't it?
Yes, I knew my place.
You, of course, were a television person, as you indicated, more so than radio. Did you find there to be a huge difference in the way you approached the work?
Yes, I did. I mean, I much preferred doing interviews on radio, because you can have your little bits around you and you can talk during the records and you can get to know your interviewee. On telly, it's much more stark than that. And, of course, you can wear what you like on radio. That's what any broadcaster will know. And you had to wear... Originally, I wore the communal dinner jacket when I was an announcer on television, just one huge dinner jacket we all shared. And then, of course, the gents... natty, and whereas you, of course, have been wearing your loincloth steadily for 35 years on Radio 2.
And, I really must wash it one day.
Yes, that would be nice, but it doesn't show, it doesn't notice. But the great thing is, apart from the fact that you feel cosy and you're surrounded by bits of information and even your family photographs, if you want to, on radio, whether you're on TV or radio, you always, as we all know, just address one person. And that works in both ways. If you think of your audience in millions, you're done for.
Absolutely. Absolutely right. We've asked you to choose a piece of music for our listeners' delectation. What would you like to hear?
Well, there was one record which caused a sort of frisson of controversy at the time. It was the first record between the father and daughter. And I'm talking, of course, about Something Stupid, Frank and Nancy Sinatra. And the bosses at Reprise were a bit worried about it as well. But Frank said it'll work. And it did, because it became his second gold record and the only one, by number one, by father and daughter. And he got nominated for Record of the Year at the 10th Grammy Awards. So how about that? It's an unusual song. I don't think we'll hear its like again.
Frank and Nancy Sinatra, father and daughter, as Michael Aspel said, with Something Stupid. Mike, the early days of Radio 2, there was a great camaraderie about the place.
Yes, there was. The strange thing is, of course, is people don't realise that we broadcasters don't all know each other because we work at different times and our paths simply don't cross a lot. But Kenny Everett was at full strength at that time, and John Dunn doing his evening shows. I always looked up to him. He was 6'7". But Kenny Everett used to do a programme on Sunday mornings on Radio 1 before Family Favourites, which came on at midday, but broadcast on Radios 1 and 2. And Kenny knew this, and he knew that he could send me up for the last 10 minutes of his show, knowing that I couldn't respond because half my audience hadn't heard his show. So he would say, I'm now going to spend the next 2 hours pretending to be Michael Aspel, and he did these funny pseudo-posh voices, and I had to come up gritting my teeth and unable to respond. But that was the joy of the radio and the fun you could have.
Happy days. Television, of course, you had so many successes, but I think one programme that everybody associates with you is This Is Your Life, which you have to be a well-known face to present because you have to have that access to people and to be instantly recognised. But not everybody wants to be put through the experience of This Is Your Life.
No, some people regard it as the greatest accolade you could possibly have, and others regard it as a rude intrusion. But you would only do it having consulted the nearest and dearest, and if they say yes, he or she would like it, you do it. And if they say, I think they'd rather die, then you don't. And, of course, a lot of the people that we approach wouldn't know who I was. For example, I was lowered by helicopter once onto the deck of a boat. I think it was a fishing boat. And this old guy who was steering it was the oldest of his kind in the world, almost. And I fought my way across his heaving deck and got up to him at the wheel and said, hey, Charlie, this is your life. And he said, oh, yeah. And he wasn't slightly interested. He just kept looking ahead and steering the boat as if I hadn't said a word. And we did a lovely show. We was, you know, educated into what we were there for.
And after all that effort, didn't even...
Yeah, didn't want to know.
Wasn't impressed at all.
But others were actually knew what it was, which was a genuine tribute.
Well, it's a show we still miss, I think. And we still miss hearing you on the radio, Michael. Are you planning a comeback anytime soon?
No, I'm not. No. I think the last thing I did was a couple of documentaries on Radio 2, one about evacuation and one about national service, both of which I went through. And I don't think I've been through anything else worth talking about since then.
I think it's time we had you back, really, because you're sounding...
Why don't we do a programme together? I would love to do that, because I do enjoy listening to you, Ken.
Oh,
that would be fun.
Very, very kind. We must do that. It's lovely to hear you sounding bright and cheerful as always. And before you go, choose another piece of music for us. Well, another favourite, if you don't mind.
Well, we need something up, don't we? So how about sort of Up, Up and Away? You know, the great Jimmy Webb, who... still around, and he's done his latest biography. I think it's called The Cake and the Rain. I mean, Up and Away qualifies as sunshine pop, I think they call it, and psychedelic, and to me it was cheerful and slightly cross-eyed music and great adverts for airlines, etc. But Up and Away always reminded me of my boyhood hero, the Lone Ranger. Do you remember? He always galloped off at the end of each movie on his white horse saying, hi-ho, Silver, away!
That's right, yes. So, as you gallop off on your horse, thank you so much for joining us, Mike. It's been a pleasure to speak to you again.
Thank you, Ken. Same to you.
The Fifth Dimension, Up, Up and Away, chosen by Michael Aspel. What a pleasure to speak to Mike Aspel today again, and remembering, as he did there, the late 60s and that time in Radio 2. Stereo sounds from Radio 2.